How are you all doing?
Good.
Good, excellent. Are you in the right spot? Is this a class in secondary education for pedagogy and curriculum?
Yes.
Right on, good. I'm glad to see you. We are here, we're in the sort of the downward sort of slope of our Hess week. We have a scholar in residence come in from the Robert L. Hess Fund. And we get a prominent scholar in the field, of any field, come for a week and stay with us and interact with students and give a memorial lecture, have luncheons, etc. And we have an opportunity to have an anthropologist here, Dr. John Jackson, from Penn, from the University of Pennsylvania. He is a dean there, and he is the Richard Perry University professor. He's been at the Annenberg School, as well as now as the dean of the School of Social Policy and Practice. So he's a very generous scholar, a very prestigious scholar, and a social activist to boot. So, and today we're gonna be talking a little bit about impolite conversations in the classroom, and he wrote a book, co-author Cora Daniels, titled Impolite Conversations, and how to talk about race, religion, gender, sex, etc. So please help me welcome Dean Jackson.
The cameraman is allowing me to step away from the microphone to be a little closer to the audience. I feel like that's something I haven't quite done yet, so I hope it doesn't freak you all out too much. But I'm in the aisle. We'll probably be coming even closer before everything is done. So what I thought I would do, I have written about impolite conversations. I have tried to both write in op-eds and in journal articles and in book form about political correctness. I mean, it's one of these things people imagine to be real and significant. I'm not sure I always buy it, but I would want to talk to folks who are, most of you all are here, at least as students, because you intend to be teachers or you're already teachers.
Mm-hmm.
Already teachers. Already teachers. And so I don't know how anxious you all are about the idea of how to incorporate hot button political issues into classroom discussion. But it's one of the things I have to admit I'm often the most excited about doing, and for a couple of different reasons for me. So I end up, the good thing about, there are a lot of good things I think about the 11 years now I've been at Penn, but one of the things I can say is that I've only ever had to teach courses I really wanted to teach. And I don't think I've ever taught the same course twice, maybe one time. But part of what it means is I'm constantly trying to figure out different ways of engaging students on the issues that I think are important to me, that I care about. And for a lot of students, at least the ones who gravitate to my courses, also important to them. So I teach courses in American racism. I teach courses specifically about the ways in which we think about urban conflict and try to negotiate. I think about how we represent difference in film and on radio. What are the politics of representation? And often, one of the ways in which we begin our discussions is with some set of ground rules about what it means to participate. Because I do think often the key in those kind of courses is to make sure people feel like it's a quote-unquote safe enough environment to be just a little bit uncomfortable enough to be potentially moved. And so that's the kind of balance we often try to pull off. And I think there are a few different, I'm sure you all have techniques you use for trying to do that, but I have ones that at least I've found at the undergraduate level, to a certain extent with PhD students and master's students as well, can often work very well for me. So I thought maybe I'd talk about some of that, hear the kinds of things you all are interested in and want to unpack. I don't know how many people are anxious about how politics informs the flow of their classroom discussions. How many folks have had issues before around that stuff? Like when you, what's most anxiety producing to you about that? What's worst case scenario?
I mean, I just don't
want to
say the wrong thing about the wrong group, because I don't understand your viewpoint or your struggle, and I don't want to say the wrong thing and make it somehow worse for you.
And of course, we all know how easy it is to say the wrong thing. Right? I mean, it's kind of, for a whole bunch of reasons, effortlessly, we put our foot in our mouths all the time. Right? And so, that you're right, that's something we, especially as teachers who talk, who have to fill up a lot of time, chances are you can fall into one of those cul-de-sacs.
I think as teachers and even young teachers, there's this pressure to kind of always be middle of the road so that then allow your students to determine their own path. And it doesn't allow for a lot of individuality to shine through in your classroom. And so, you know, we are still people and we still have our own beliefs. And how do we kind of flirt with that, the political nature of having to, or feeling the pressure of having to maintain this bipartisan, you know, stance for students that, so to speak.
That's a good point. And that's the trade-off. The trade-off, you kind of got to stick to the middle, right? And try to be as careful and in some ways so cumulatory as you have to be to avoid what we know to be third rail issues, so ways of unpacking topics people care about that can get them riled up, get them upset. Also in a context where we know places like this one already Milan characterized as being bastions of far left radicalism. Right? So this idea, this is already not education, it's indoctrination. Right? That's what folks on the right want to argue. So you're negotiating that hyper-politicized context as well. And folks are all the more ready and have all the tools at their disposal to out-indoctrinating professors. We see versions of that all the time. Fox News will cover it every other night, if you like. And so how do you deal with some of that stuff as well? Well, you know, what happens in the classroom doesn't stay in the classroom either. And so the issues can escalate in ways you can lose control of as professors. So I think that's also good. Any other things that you think about as you try to figure out how to navigate some of the political issues that are gonna, even if you're writing or teaching about ostensibly apolitical topics, still find their way. And I think they should. You know, one of the things I always try to remind my students is that it's difficult just teaching algebra. Right? I mean, it's difficult teaching stuff we imagine to be non-political or differently, not easily politicized. How much more difficult have we raised the level of complexity? We're going to try to talk about issues of gender or sexuality or religion. I mean, what I love, so I actually teach a lot of courses on religion. And one of my favorite courses, actually, that I taught was a course that I sort of described as this sort of introduction to the anthropology of religion meets introduction to communication. And it was all framed around the idea that one of the things most societies do is have this sense that we have some way of communicating with other sentient beings in some other realm. We might call them gods, demons, angels. We might use mechanisms called prayer or seances or, you know, the ifa, but we communicate with these otherworldly beings. I think that's anthropologically, that's fascinating. So what are the logics behind how we do that? What are the commonalities between and among all of those different techniques and technologies we use to produce the possibility of that kind of conversation? Now, what does it say about who we are as a species? What does it say? That we've created these very elaborate techniques for speaking to people who are already dead, who have never been in flesh at all. As an anthropologist, I get excited just thinking about that. And so I want to feel like, you know, the difficult thing about teaching religion, I would argue, maybe even more than any of the others, for me, is it's also one of these things that, as academics, in mixed company, you're not even really supposed to have yourself. Right? We're cold, rational beings. Right? We don't believe in otherworldly entities that we can't verify, right? We can't objectively prove. And so, I mean, I remember just growing up as a kid, one of the things you would hear in the congregations that I attended was this kind of backlash against the even idea of going to college. Because one of the things you'll do as soon as you walk through the door is unlearn God. So there's all of that stuff. And so what I love about teaching is, you know, people come into that classroom, believers. And so how are you gonna be able to frame a conversation that's critical, but also respectful? That recognizes that they're not, just because they believe in Jesus or Krishna or Muhammad doesn't mean they believe in anything more fanciful than the other kind of stuff I believe that I bring into the classroom with me. And so just trying to be sensitive to the fact that all the most important things we want to talk about aren't simply academic. People are invested. They care about it. They take it personally. And so one of the ways, at least I try, and sometimes I think I do a better job than others, but one of the ways I try to at least set up ground rules in a space to allow people to realize or to appreciate the possibility that I might be worth talking to about this stuff, especially when they really care about it and don't want it harmed or destroyed, is to be able to demonstrate to them that I actually listen. Right, that I've listened to the various sides of any debate, conversation, conflagration. And I demonstrate that, I think, most effectively by doing the best job I can of not just representing what they might imagine to be my own position on a particular topic, whether it's affirmative action, criminal justice and race and discrimination, gender bias, and whatever the topic might be, what I try to do as best as I can is to demonstrate to them that I can render both sides in as compelling a way as possible. And I do that for a couple of reasons. One, because it does demonstrate a capacity to actually listen to the nuances of arguments. Often what we prefer is to have straw people up there with the least sophisticated version of the other side, and we can rip it down really quickly. But if it were that easy, we would have solved it, right? Because we're a smart species. So it's actually harder than that. And so part of what I try to let them know is you can at least, at the very least, trust that when I'm done describing what some students might imagine to be the other side, I know I'm effective if I've done it with a level of care and nuance and persuasiveness that they at least see why it can be complicated. Doesn't mean they change their belief. In some ways, my job isn't to change students' beliefs. My job is to get students to think about why they believe what they believe. Then it's on them. But why? And it might mean you double down on stuff. But as long as you have to do it in and through a version, the cauldron, the crucible of real, serious social criticality. And so that's a version of what. So I try to show that I can do, even when there aren't really both sides, so I think there are some issues where, at least as far as I'm concerned, my moral ethical compass, there aren't really two equivalent sides. But I try to do a better job than, say, even the Fox News on what might be the conservative version of a particular argument. Because what I want them to also realize is your job as a contributor to the discussion is to demonstrate that same commitment to active listening. The joke that if you have any of my students, undergrads, not grad students, any of my undergraduates, I'll tell you what I tell them about, any classroom you have a certain percentage of grade for class participation. What I tell them is class participation for me means you have to show me. I have to see you listening. Right? So I don't know, you gotta do this, you gotta show me, I gotta see you act. That's what you can talk all you want. That's not gonna make the grade for participation. Show me what listening looks like. You show me in the behavior, and you show me giving back to your classmates versions of what they said that resonated. Show me that you're hearing it. We can have a discussion if you don't start there. So in some ways, that's a version of way of thinking about saying, it's not about me getting you to believe something different. It's getting you to hear me. You don't have to agree with me, but you have to hear what the logic of the argument is. If you don't understand it, you need to know what the maneuvers are, what the analytical moves are. Ask me to clarify. That's often enough to get people to say, okay, I have to think about that again. But the key is, I think, to demonstrate the willingness to hear. So I think that's one of the biggest things. And the way I start to do that is to at least have heard the iterations of the arguments on both sides of a debate in ways that can allow me to stand in for both sides. So one of the ways that can be effective, just in a very practical way, is often I'm more confident of the way I will articulate stuff. Like I'll be thinking about all the potential landmines and I'll try to maneuver around them. Students won't see me doing that, but I'll try to tell them doing it or not. But students aren't equipped to do that, aren't thinking about that as much, right? Might not be able to figure it out. So often one of the biggest issues I have to deal with is a student who's trying to make an unpopular point and doing it in the least elegant way possible. Like, that's really tough. Because then what happens? Everyone else in the classroom turns against them. It won't be one isolated incident. It'll probably happen a second time. And there'll be all this discourse, right, around what this student represents. And so one of the things I have to do, I feel like, in that moment, is throw that student a lifeline. That is to say, be a partner in crime to elevate the discourse about what, take out the stuff that is getting in the way of students assimilating the core point that should and could be made, from the noise that gets in the way and makes it impossible to hear. And it takes a lot of work sometimes to do that. But it means excavating what's still useful. Because I'm one of these folks who thinks, almost no matter what's said in the classroom, there's something about it that we can use. My job is to figure out what is that. Sometimes it takes a lot of work. But I've yet to have a scenario where someone introduces something into the context that I can't find some way to recuperate and to make a structurally constructive way of pushing the arguments forward in a way that we can all benefit from. But that, to me, is often the most difficult job. I'm more confident of my own ability to navigate that terrain than I am often of students feeling comfortable enough to do that. And what's great about doing that even once or twice effectively, because then it means two things happen, if you're lucky. One is students don't just obsess on the nature of how the argument was made in the first iteration, but move to the substance of what the core is behind it and try to grapple with that. But then you also demonstrate a willingness to go into the muck and try to figure out, even in the most unpopular of discussions, how to find a way to get a point that we can use together to push our conversation into what I would imagine be a fruitful direction. I think it takes work, but it's worth doing. I find everyone benefits in that scenario. So the students who might imagine on more issues than not, they're mostly in agreement. We think they're on the right side of the issue, right, the right side of history. I think it gives them a way of hearing versions of arguments that if they're not said carefully enough, they shut down and won't take seriously enough to really interrogate. I argue one of the worst things we do from any ideological position is to think we already know the answer before the question is asked. And so it gets them out of that mindset. But then I think the other thing it does is create these moments where folks can think, well, if I say something unpopular, or I say something in a non-graceful way, I can trust that the instructor will find a way to help contort it into something we can all know. And I think it gives me a little bit more freedom to be honest and truthful. I do think we want honesty, right? So the biggest critique, of course, against political correctness is, and I think this is the version of what I write about in racial paranoia, right? When I talk about Harlemites pining for the South, folks, almost no matter what class, location, no matter what age, talking about when they get enough money, resources, when they retire, they're gonna move down to the South. Part of what those Harlemites are talking about is a version of what is the center of this discussion about political correctness. Because when Harlemites say they want to go down to the South, what are they really saying? For folks who haven't lived there. If a Harlemite in 1997 is telling me they can't wait to move down to South Carolina or Alabama, what's their rationale? Harlem is the Mecca. Who would ever want to leave Harlem? It's not like they're saying they want to go to Brooklyn.
But, and I haven't read the book, but I was, you know, and also my family is from the Caribbean, you know, so there's another narrative about, okay, we're going to go back home, you know, when we retire, we'll go back to Jamaica. But, you know, on the one hand, old people don't like to be in the cold. You know, but, and then there's also the wealth that you have, you know, and how far it would stretch in the South as opposed to being up in Harlem, you know. But I think it's also a return to something that is home and that's familiar and you know, probably a past that's imagined, that it's like, okay, I came here, I worked, I got my money, and then I get to return to something that's more comfortable.
That's perfect. And I think all of that is operative, right? So clearly, even for the folks who told me they wanted to go to Harlem, I mean, wanted to go to the South, who weren't from the South. Even for those folks, there is this almost this mythical sense of going back home, right? To some sort of ancestral home that's offered there. In the same way you're talking about the Caribbean. Most people don't do it, but at least they have the rhetoric for it. And I think there's also this sense that in the South, money goes farther, life slows down, all that kind of stuff. That really wasn't the part of it I found most provocative. So one of the themes that came up over and over again, along with those, so clearly it's embedded, it's entangled in that stuff, was also this idea. Anybody want to jump in? That at least as a black person in the South, you knew where you stood vis-a-vis white people. Right? This idea that in the South, white people wouldn't feel shackled by political correctness to tell you what they think you want to hear. And that they can't trust, in a sense, their cross-racial interactions in a place like New York. Because people know better, right? So the idea is, if you go down, and again, this is, I'm not sure what South, this is this mythical South, right? But this idea that at least Southern whites make it clear who's on your side, who's not on your side, who wears the white hat, who wears the black hat. So this fan, and if there's something about that, I would argue that's just existential comfort. It's difficult to imagine you can have a, you can be having a conversation with someone and not believe you can trust what they say. That's a tough world to live in. Right? And so I do think they're both sides of this debate, the side that feels relatively silenced, right? I don't know how to talk about transgender identity well, so I'll just be quiet about it, right? But then the other side of it is this sense that, well, we have had so many decades of explicit commitments to racialized thinking. Can I really trust all the wonderful things white folks in New York City are saying to my face about race? Where did all the racial wolves go, is the way I put it, the racial paranoia. But there's a version of that dynamic that I think is something that taxes our ability to talk across what Du Bois once called the color line in America. You had your hand up. Oh, yeah, no?
Oh, well, it did actually remind me of today I actually talked about the Great Migration with my students, and we talked about, you know, so the, you know, facts and events behind it, but then what happens when people get to New York, what, and to, you know, the various cities. And the students, they were actually very astute. They said, okay, but, you know, so of course now they're up there, and now, but what's, how does that answer, you know, this land of hope? And they, you know, they commented on it. They said, well, at least in the South, you knew where you stood, though, probably, right? And I said, yeah, that, I think that's an excellent observation, because now you're here. There's no legal Jim Crow laws on the books like that, but they were able, you know, they were able to sort of understand that in some sort of inherent way. They knew where they stood.
College students?
10th grade.
10th grade, yeah. I mean, again, I was telling the students earlier, I'm always blown away by just how analytically sophisticated, non-academic, that they're thinking deeply about this stuff. So I think that's absolutely, in the sweet spot of what I'm trying to say. I heard quite distinctively, repeatedly, in Harlem in the 1990s, from folks who had never even been to the South, right? But who understood the South as this place. Again, it's difficult to imagine you're going to be having conversations with folks you can't even trust. What kind of dynamic is that? It's a version, I think, of what often makes the classroom incredibly toxic. Because if people imagine they can't trust you as the instructor to lead them through sometimes very treacherous waters, they shut down. On every side of the debate, right? So if you're allowing crazy people, right, who are talking about things that are clearly explicitly offensive, to monopolize time, to bully people. If you're allowing stuff to happen that shouldn't happen, it's your fault, and you're gonna lose the rest of the class. If, in a way, part of what you're doing is allowing the consensus to silence the critical minority that might have important contributions to make the conversation more real, more reflective of debates going on in the world, then you've lost that. Right? The sort of consensus is at the expense of allowing these sort of critical interjections into that sort of, you know, business as usual assumption about how we think about the world to fall by the wayside. And I think there's a version of that that's also, for me, one of the most frightening versions of what a classroom that's organized around these sort of hot button political and social issues, one of the worst traps it can fall into, is to think that just because we all agree, or because we say we all agree, means we do. How many times in a classroom does someone say something that you're like, wow, like that? I don't know if I agree with that. Second, third, fourth person says it. What you want to be able to create, obviously, in that space is folks to feel comfortable and safe and confident enough to say, you know what? I'm not sure that's true. And this is why. I think it's actually often a good thing to be sort of respectfully, carefully, and generously unpopular. That's different from being nasty, mean, dismissive. It's not what I'm talking about. It's about trying to figure out a way, and this starts, I think, introspectively. It starts with a certain kind of self-critical reflexivity. What are the things I should be challenging about my own beliefs? And in some ways, that's often for me, at least as a teacher, one of the safest places to settle, and one of the safest places to rest, is how do I get students not to debate one another about the issues, but to interrogate their own assumptions about the issues. I mean, that's always, I think, a more interesting organizing principle for what conversations should look like. And again, I always tell people I kind of get that out of ethnography, in a way. Because, and I try to demonstrate this, you know, more explicitly in some versions of my writing, but one of the things I claim ethnography allows you to do is it allows you to be willing and able to tease out of people some of the least flattering versions of who and what they are. It allows you to have them feel comfortable enough, safe enough, to show you the underbelly of their beliefs. Right? Not just the stuff they say in mixed company, not just what they think people want to hear, not just what will get them a job, but what they think they actually believe, what motivates their decisions on a day-to-day basis. And the way you do that, very simply, how do you do it? You listen, and you ask a question. In some ways, part of what I would argue is, you know, asking of a carefully crafted question is like a revolution in a conversation. I think it really is. And that's what I think the best ethnographers learn to do. They learn to ask questions that don't have, in an explicit way, all the kind of dismissive and hostile versions of an answer to the question already in plain view. And I think it actually takes discipline to do that. Because what I don't want to feel like I'm doing when I'm in the field is I don't want to feel like I'm angry, upset, dismissive, hostile to my interlocutor. But I'm going to pretend something else. I'm not sure I could ever do ethnography that way. I'm not sure if even the difference makes a difference to you, but that's not what I want to be happening in that moment. In that moment, what I want to be happening is, wow, listen to what you just said. Please tell me more about how you got there. How did you get there? The version of that story I tell in the book, Impolite Conversation, is, you know, just this Italian tow truck driver who has to pick me up in Philadelphia and is driving me. You know, black guy, Italian guy, used to live in South Philly where I now live, left, ostensibly, as he tells me, because of all the Latinos. And he waxed on about Latino in-migration. And I think there are a whole bunch of amazing lessons there. I mean, lessons you already know. One is how effortlessly, actually, we can build cross-racial conversation community on the back of some other people, right? So the idea is the people not in the cab or the truck are the problem. Right? I mean, that's a powerful gesture. And we do that all the time. We do that all the purposefully or inadvertently. We do that. And so that was one moment I thought, wow, it's fascinating. I clearly am interested in what it is, what was so problematic about Latino. I want to know. And to genuinely want to know means you perk up, you ask the question, and you listen to the answer. Then when the answer comes, it begs another question. Right? Our ride was probably no more than 35 minutes. I'm sure it felt like a day in a way, because there was so much ground we covered. But again, in a way that I don't think he would have felt was hostile. Right? So one thing I think I always tell my students who are having a horrible time in somebody else's class, because they won't have it in my class, is treat that space like an ethnographic field site. Right? And you do that for a couple reasons. One reason why you would do that is if you're an ethnographer, part of what you're trying to figure out is what's happening in that room to create the dynamics that constitute it. So it kind of takes you just a little, one step removed from how boring the professor is or how uninspired the conversation is to looking at how the dynamics of the education experience are being organized. Right? So think about things ethnographically. What do you see? Who's doing what? How are they doing? How are the ideas circulating? And I think once you do that, then it takes the pressure off the course to give you everything you need in just the way you need it. And it makes you less frustrated than curious about how the dynamic is operating. And there's a version of that that I think also goes into those moments when you're talking to someone about something that at a certain level one could be angry about, hostile to, feel offended by. But in an ethnographic modality, your job is to understand. Ultimately, you could still have a political end game. But even if that's the case, even if at the end of the day, what you want to do is change hearts and minds, still there's, I would argue, only one path to doing that. It's a version of this careful, listening-based engagement. And I think a classroom space is the perfect space for it.
So pedagogically, what do you do to support your undergraduates to have this ethnographic modality or to practice it or to enact it? Do you have a structured approach that you take?
So I've really never done it in one of my classes, or except as professor, being at Bowdoin Group, unbeknownst to them. But often it's about getting my students in, again, another class, to think about all the tools they can use to enter that space differently. Right. So one of the things I think the ethnographer lets go of his, her, their interests and aims as the first order of business, right? Because your job is to understand what other folks are doing in that world. Now, I still would argue, and my students at least who've tried to do this in the past claim that it happened, they're not going to miss any of the information. It's not going to distract them from the subject matter. What it can often do, I think, though, is allow you to not get frustrated about what's not happening. So I think often, so even though I don't wire in any explicit way into the dynamics, the curriculum, or the syllabus of the courses I teach, one of the things I want to imagine I'm modeling in the front is the same kind of open, listening-based interface with other students in the classroom that says, well, I'm not, you know, if you say you disagree with me, I love when students disagree. That's fantastic, right? That, because it means a whole bunch of things. It means clearly I didn't say what I said convincing, what I should have said convincingly enough, and that's good. But it also means they're going to have to explain to me why their position is more tenable than mine. And we'll all think it through. But my investment isn't in the rightness or wrongness of my position. My investment is figuring out what the distance is between what I think I'm explaining about the world and what they're imagining in some kind of counterfactual way that they themselves have experienced or that they want to theorize about that self-same world. And I think that's, to me, that's what we're educating. The sparks that fly from that are exactly what we want. And so I think sometimes there's a way in which you fall into the trap of believing that our only role in the classroom is to have the right answer and to not be proven wrong or to not have students ask the question you don't know the answer to. I think our job is to try to get students to make sure they're asking themselves how to come to some version of what might be an answer to these tough questions in ways that they feel like they can champion and justify. And so maybe at some point in the future when I teach again, I don't know when I'm going to teach again as a full-time administrator, but at some point it might be worth it to more explicitly set up a kind of ethnographic scenario for the students and have us play those roles. But I think implicit in the kind of dynamics I want to set up in the classroom is a version of every student in there feeling empowered to represent their own ethnographic sensibility. And I think to do that means, again, starting with this idea of trying to figure out not why this person believes something so horrible and attaching them, but figuring out why this person believes something so amazingly horrible. How is that possible? How did they get there? And often they can't tell. And I guess that's the biggest thing. So I think what you learn from ethnography is it's not enough to ask. Right? We ask questions all the time. We ask left and right. Right? We'll transcribe it. But it's not enough to ask. You ask, you observe, you ask again. But then you also have to always be open to the idea that your interlocutor might not be able to explain to you really why and how they come to believe what they believe. And even that can sometimes be an incredibly ground-shaking experience for a student to not actually feel like they have the skills to justify what they feel, what they believe. And again, justify is even strong. The idea is, how do you get there? And so being able to ask the question in a way that isn't intrinsically hostile, isn't accusatory, doesn't attack, but forces them to go back and think more deeply about the space between what they imagined they could explain and justify and the stuff, the wide chasm that opens up between what they actually can.
So then is it sort of also your job to try and help them learn how to explain? Or
I think it's always good to be able to communicate as well as you can. Right? So I think that'll, no matter what you want to do professionally, no matter what community you're a part of, all things being equal, it's better to be able to communicate effectively what you think about. So I think that should be a byproduct in some way. So yes, ultimately, I still think though that's, in a way, I would say epiphenomenal. I think what really should be going on that manifests in that ability to communicate more effectively what they believe is a real genuine interrogation, a real attempt to understand and explain to and for themselves how they come to believe a certain thing in a certain way. Again, not even necessarily to change, but I think being critical has to mean being open to change. And that's for everybody, right? That's for everybody, including the teacher at the front of the room, which I also find, for me, incredibly exhilarating. I think I said my first, maybe I didn't say it, now that there's so many talks, I can't remember. But you know, one of the things I've always been sort of driven to as an ethnography of, you know, the Hebrew Israelites, I've worked with the Nubian Nation. I've done a lot of interesting ethnographic work. And often I'll be working with communities or in communities where, you know, there's a kind of tug of war going on. Where, I mean, if it's looking at Hebrew Israelites who are telling me how and why everything we think we know about Black history is not just a lie, but a conspiratorial fiction that's served up to keep me and folks like me blind, right? And they have the evidence for it. They send me with a list of books to Columbia's library that they can bring back and show me in the books at Columbia how and why they're right. Like, that stuff to me is really a volatile situation. And there's a version of me in a romantic mode that always wants them to win, right? Like, ultimately, I'm coming in there with my anthropological cards. I think, you know, with Boaz and Margaret Mead and Zora Neale Hurston, these are, you know, the figures that I'm carrying with me, my spiritual guides into that space. And they're coming with other folks. And part of what happens in that moment is, if they're compelling enough, I think I could be open enough to be changed. And I want to imagine, to really do this work well means you have to see how and why this other position is compelling. Right? How and why it can feel like a wonderful world to situate yourself in, like a stable one, like an empowering one. And so to be able to do that, though, means you have to be willing yourself to, in a way that's genuine, that is serious, to engage them on terms that might destabilize the ground you stand on. And I feel like I've had moments like that. I try to write a little bit about some of them in some of the ethnography. Ultimately, I feel like, you know, I'm still always the ethnographer. So I come out, I survive, I write the book, right? But there is a version of that that I think also describes, at least for me, what I want to imagine the stakes are in a classroom context. Students are there. The reason why it's inspiring, the reason why I like to teach is because students change my mind about stuff I've studied for a long time, right? And I think there's something about that that is incredibly exciting. I mean, I'm sure there are students in the classes whose minds get changed as well, and that's great. But I think the worst thing is to kind of just be preaching to the choir and we're all singing the same tune and we start that way and we come out the same way, just maybe, you know, with a little better pitch and more in unison or something. Like, I'm not sure, I mean, there's something about that actually can feel satisfying. But that's not the only job we have, pedagogical, right? And so ultimately, I do want to believe, you know, our job is self-reflection. It's to think about, you know, what does it mean? If students are constantly asking you questions you can't answer, that's important. Why can't you answer those questions? Doesn't mean necessarily you're a bad teacher, you're not smart, but something's happening there, right? It's an ethnographic data point, right? Take yourself off the hook. It's not about how bad a teacher you are. There's ethnographic information that's flying in that you can then try to figure out. And I think that's also a way to kind of de-escalate the stakes of it. Because we're always thinking, well, am I good or bad at this? Am I smart? Am I not? And there's almost no way to get around that. But the ethnographer, right, taking on the sort of pith-helmeted ethnographer role allows you to mitigate some of those anxieties a little bit. So it's not just always about how good or bad a teacher you are, you know what I mean? How smart, how much you know. It's more about how engaged can you be. And when there's stuff you don't know, is it important to figure out how and why to get that information covered in a way that would be useful to them? But I think that's exciting stuff, I feel like.
You know, it sounds to me like the teacher has to be human and has to bring a certain amount of vulnerability and concern to the classroom. You know, I taught African dance like a lifetime ago to adults and kids, but when I got a group of kids, you know, there was always this hierarchy that emerged immediately. You know, you'd have your cool girls and they have their crew and they're always in the front and they would, you know, but there would always be a handful of kids who could barely look you in the eye to tell you their name, you know, that just their self-esteem. And I kind of always was concerned beyond the subject matter, what is this that I'm doing with this interaction with these kids, you know? And to me, that's the thing, and you speak about, you know, being ethnographic, that even when I did get in the field, you know, it was that same kind of concern for those ones on the fringes and wanting to touch them and make them look at me or listen to what was going on with them or hear their story. You know, I felt like that, like me teaching them, if it was going to be effective, like I had to bring all of those parts of myself, you know, to the experience. I feel like I remember reading something by bell hooks about like even like having a body in the classroom, you know, and then not just be an interaction between you and the subject matter, giving it to the kids, but like, what if you gotta take a piss? You know, like what if in the middle of this thing, like how do you become fleshy and human in that space, you know, beyond just, you know, this exchange of information? That's a lot.
That's a lot. I mean, I think that one of the ways I own up to my end game is to say, you have to care about the people you teach. I mean, maybe you don't, maybe I'm wrong, but I couldn't do it unless I cared about the people I was teaching. And so there's a version of that that might be about embodiment, it might be about thinking about ourselves, not just as folks who give certain grades on a test, but as human beings who are there to be inspired and to be recognized, to be seen, right? To be appreciated. And I think there's a version of that that really is the kind of engine for my pedagogical practice. Like, I want to care about the folks in that space. I want them to care about me. It is a version, and I think it is, and what I will at least own up to is the fact that it is a particular perspective. I talked about Fred Wiseman, this documentary filmmaker earlier. And I remember one of the first academics, so I think he's the most important American documentarian ever. Tons of films, all important, especially if you're interested in issues about institutional change, macro structural forces, like the stuff he makes, powerful, and like no other filmmaker on the planet. But I'm not his press agent, but I do think that's true. And I remember my first panel at the University of Michigan, I think it was, panel about ethnographic film or film and representation, and he was on the panel. Ridiculous that I was on the panel at all. And I remember him talking about his approach to doing his film. So if you don't know about Fred Wiseman, he does these kind of long-form observational films. So it's a version, the closest version you can get to filmically of an ethnographic methodology. So he'll go to a housing project complex for 9 months, for a year, and just shoot people's experiences and interaction. He's not doing any interviews, right? He's just shooting what he's seeing. And often putting together these masterful and incredibly engrossing stories about how people interact in welfare offices, in insane asylums, in housing project complexes in Chicago. And what he said in that room, and I'll never forget it, because there's something about it to me that to this day feels more honest, than the position I laid out? And what he said was, so when he goes in, he tells the community, he says, you know, I want you to come here, so if it's in a housing project complex, they go to, you know, one of the sort of community centers and one of the buildings, and I'm gonna tell you what we're about to do. We're about to do something that's gonna feel incredibly intimate. But I have a small crew, we're gonna be with you for a long time. And we're gonna get very close to you. We're gonna learn a lot about you. We're gonna try to do justice to your story with the camera. We're gonna try our best to do it. And I think when you see his films, he takes seriously that responsibility. But he says, I tell them up front that it's gonna feel incredibly intimate, really real and raw and close. And as soon as I yell cut for the last time, you will not see me again until I have a film on the show. And his point was to say, it's not about my relationship to you, I'm making a film. The only way I can make that film is to make you comfortable with me being there to allow us to get connected enough for the film to be produced. But I'm not making friends. And I remember thinking at the time when he said that, it was so different from the model of ethnographic research I took with me into Harlem. Because when I went to Harlem for the first time as a grad student, really it was this complicated way of forging relationships with people under the auspices of social scientific research. But I can tell you, if when the book was done, and you know, I remember as soon as I got the first copy, I went up and showed it to folks and gave them their copies of the book and even showed them where they were. Yeah, and they were excited about it for maybe 2 minutes. Right? And then that was it. And I can tell you, if they would have imagined that our relationship was reducible to that text, they would have really felt exploited. They would have really felt horrified. But not because of anything intrinsic to the nature of what any ethnographic project can and should be, but because of the ways in which I represented myself and my investment in that space. So I told them it was about more than just the article or the book. Because I wanted to, and still do believe, for me at least, to do the kind of work I want to do, it kind of has to do. But I always respect this argument that someone like Fred Wiseman, a master filmmaker, says, that in some ways, is the exact opposite of that position. And I can imagine that being a version of what you bring in the classroom too. Say, what's gonna feel intimate? We're gonna simulate a kind of intimacy because we're gonna be here all semester. We're gonna talk about really important things that we're gonna get very close. But I'm the teacher, I'm gonna have another class next semester, and I do not get it twisted. That's not, you know what I mean? So I think that's probably maybe even a more honest way to think about it, but that's just not how I choose to enter into the. And I think there's a version of sort of how, you know, Bell Hooks and others try to reimagine what transforming the interactions in the educational context can look like, that I think speak to versions of the limitation of imagining too instrumentalist a relationship to the classroom and the student center. But, you know, I kind of feel like I'm not wired for some reason like Wiseman, at least not completely. Although I will say, I finished my research in Harlem in 1999 or somewhere around in 98. I may have been back to Harlem 15 times. No, probably more than that. But like, I'm not in Harlem anymore. You know what I mean? So in a sense, I did a version of the Wiseman here.
Yeah, I guess what I'm hearing from what you're saying is kind of touching on a debate in our class. I would argue, at least for me, and what you're saying kind of makes sense to me as far as it being the personality of the individual might be how you want to go about it, but for me, we always talk about bias from the teacher influencing what occurs in the classroom. And you know, I generally take the position that I want to remain not too impartial, but impartial in a way that can kind of foster the space that you're speaking of. Like, I think kind of not making it clear, even though it might be clear in just my mannerisms when someone says something, but as best as possible, trying to remain impartial with a certain issue, whatever we're trying to talk about. And a lot of my classmates would say, no, maybe put your idea out there first, because that could foster, you know, having a close relationship. If your students know who you are, then they feel free to express themselves more than kind of just the impartial space. And I guess I would just ask you, and you kind of just answered it, but like, do you believe that the impartial Wiseman position is one? Because I would say that's probably my position. It seems like you do respect it, but is it something that could produce the, would it make students who are somewhat afraid to, do students need to feel a personal relationship with you in order to be as free as possible?
And probably not all students, correct? I mean, students aren't all wired the same way. It's just not one size fits all for mentoring or teaching and all that stuff too. And I will say at some level, respectfully, I think Wiseman's also probably a liar. Maybe not about that, but you know, he's also said that you know he makes films that aren't critiques of American institutions, right? That all he does is objectively try to show you what's there, and people read in all of these critical articulations. And honestly, I think that he has to be playing with us. He is making critical films, but he claims he's not. You know, I think my position would be, I think I would less rely on the term impartial and say, like, the dynamic I'm going to do in the class is a version of bipartiality. Right? So I want to be able to give you both extremes, all the stuff in the middle, do it all compellingly, but also demonstrate that I'm doing it lovingly in a way that's not about marginalizing anyone, not about excluding anyone, but trying to be as open and inclusive as possible in terms of identity, in terms of ideology, in terms of positionality. And so I think it's about, so it's not about saying, well, I'm not gonna tell students what I believe. I mean, sometimes I don't think they know, and I think that's, it was a good thing because I make the case for both all three of the sides, and I can make them pretty well if I've done my homework. I want to be able to get into that classroom and explain to them why we even have to talk about it at all. Because if it was that simple, we don't need to open up a book, right? It has to be more complicated. So the way for me to do that is to demonstrate that to them that I can do more than one version of the argument, that I can pit the sides together and try to get them to figure out how we resolve it. But I want to imagine that even with all of those differences, one of the things that hopefully, and this is maybe an overly romantic notion, but hopefully one of the things that they can see throughout it all is that I care about them as human beings, as individuals. And that there's something about that that'll get us through a lot of our issues over the course of the semester. I don't know if you all know Adam Grant, one of my colleagues at the Wharton School, who wrote this book called Give and Take. I don't know if you've heard of the book. He got a lot of play a few years ago. And he got a lot of play because he's a business professor, right? And so a Wharton professor whose argument basically was, if you want to be even at your most selfish and acquisitive, like even if all you want to do is accumulate all you can for yourself, right? Even if that is your end game, that's all you want on this planet. He says, the way you do that is to give as much as you can to other people. And it's kind of a version of that sort of old biblical tale, better to give to the receive. He said, actually, even financially, it's better to give than to receive. And that the more you give to others, the more you will get back. And he measured it. He claims he can prove that that's true. So if you want to be the most selfish person in the world, perform the most ubiquitous generosity you can. Be generous. That's a version of his argument. I mean, you can imagine, that's radical in a business context, right? But I think the version of that I find important to hold on to, even just as a kind of interesting provocation, is that I do think we get a lot out of just being as generous with our students as we can be. And that means giving them time, giving them our attention. And I think that's one of the difficult things, at least for faculty on a tenure track, we're busy trying to publish, do all this other stuff. It can sometimes feel like students are the least important thing for you to deal with, right? They're a distraction from the stuff that's gonna get you job for life, right? Gonna get you the other goodies you think you want. And so you're trying quickly to get out of the class, to finish the one-on-one meeting. And I do think if there's a way to unlearn that dynamic, to realize you're gonna, even if you imagine you're spending extra time with your students, you're doing extra work for them, and it's taking you away from other things, that he wants to argue, and he does this actually as a teacher as well, so he's famous for having students staying behind class for hours on end and going, and he says all of that stuff is the reason why he's successful. And I think there's a version of that, to me, that has to translate into the classroom and into the dynamics of a semesterly or quarterly experience with students. Like, I think we have to just say, I'm gonna give you all I can to give you, and do it in a way that doesn't feel like it's debilitating. You know what I mean? So I think that's a delicate thing to pull off too, because you don't want to feel like students are sucking you dry, and when you're done, you're just a heap on the ground. You know, so you want to imagine that this that if his argument is right, it's actually replenishing you, not draining you. But you know, I think it probably takes something to figure out how to do that well. But there's a version of that to me that's about knowing that the backstop I have is they should know, if nothing else, they might not believe what I believe, but I don't think you're gonna find many Penn undergraduates taking a course with me who don't know I care about them and want them to be successful. And I think that's important. And not just because it's a popularity kind of thing, but because ultimately I want them to use that same model in the ways they interact with one another and in the spaces they occupy once they leave the University of Pennsylvania. Right? If my world is better if they can take that model into other places. And so I think that's something that for me is also a very selfish way to kind of perform a generosity, I think, would still redound back to me at some point, even indirectly. But if you haven't seen a Fred Wiseman, how many folks have seen a Fred Wiseman? I mean, incredible films.
Did you do one about a high
school?
School.
He did two. He did two about high school.
Right. High school two.
He did two, and the old one I play much more. So he also did this transition from film to video. But I mean, if you haven't seen a Fred Wiseman film, definitely check them out. I do feel like, especially if you're interested in sort of how to get people to see the everyday world a little differently, which is one thing I think we do as teachers. But how do we get students to take what they take for granted and stop doing that? To realize, wow, I could think about that differently. I think Fred Wiseman's films, if you have the patience and discipline to sit with them, are masterful examples of how film can do that too. So it's worth it if you haven't seen it. And high schools are good. Tittacus College is most famous. He has one on welfare that I often teach a lot with. But there's tons. I mean, I haven't even kept up. I haven't even seen the last five of these films. He did one on Berkeley, I think, 2 years ago, 3 years ago. I think I saw 2 hours of it or something. I can't think the whole thing was maybe 8 or 10 hours. Oh. It's a commitment. But again, his project is, I think, a pedagogical project. It's about saying, we've been trained to look at film in a particular way. And one of my jobs is to unlearn that voice, to rediscipline. And I think it's a power. I think it's very important, especially in a world that's so overdetermined by visual media, to have someone trying to get us to sit and think deeply about how we look at things. I think it's powerful, and really again a version of, I think, what's at stake in the classroom too. But definitely, if nothing else, watch a couple of Fred Wiseman films. What were you going to say?
Oh, I don't think so. I didn't have anything in mind, but actually I want to bring your attention to the fact that we read, all of us here, maybe this was already mentioned, we all read chapter 2 in Racial Paranoia, and so we've been thinking about political correctness in the context of your discussion of Dicardio racism, mm-hmm. and the historical trajectory that you present in that chapter, and at some point it would be nice to have a discussion about that.
So again, maybe the place to start is, I don't know if it's with a version of a question like, do you buy it, or is there anything about it that seemed particularly confusing or uncompelling? But I do feel like, even now, I still like this idea of trying to get people to figure out what's so complicated about having conversations with folks who we really believe might be hoarding something really horrible and negative and nasty in their hearts and never able or willing to say it out loud. Those are, I think, impossible conversations to have constructively. And so I like this idea of saying, well, what happens if we add this to the versions of how we think about race inhabiting the body politic, right? So it's in the law, and clearly we know when it's codified in law. Even when we delegalize it, it's still in the norms, right? It's still in mores, it's still in the ways in which we do things around here, right? Whether or not it has the explicit power of the state behind it the way it traditionally did. And I think that notion of, you know, de facto racism is key. And I want to imagine that it's still operative. I would argue de jure racism is still operative, right? So it's not like we've completely separated our logics of race from the ways in which we've institutionalized and codified our legal code. But I do feel like the cardio-racism also says there's a way in which we have to interrogate what's really new about this moment and about these dynamics that would allow Harlemites to say, all we want to do is go back to a place where someone will call me the N-word if that's what they feel, just so I know who I'm talking to and how I'm talking to them. And I think there's a version of that that maybe operates on a different plane in a way than the others, but I find intrinsically convincing as an anxiety people have in navigating conversations in what other folks imagine to be a politically correct world. I'm also one of these people who don't necessarily think white guilt is a real thing. I'm not sure I think that's real. I think it's no more real than white rage. I think that's a real thing. But I do imagine that one of the things we have to spend more time with is trying to figure out what are the things we're imagining we have to look at people to see and hear beyond what we can trust them telling us or something like that.
Just putting that discussion into the context of the classroom, I know we talked about being bipartisan and wanting to remain in the middle ground, but now we have this issue where we have to deal with being politically correct in the classroom. And I'm just curious as to how, I'm putting myself in the shoes of my students, how frustrating that can be. Because sometimes the students just want you to be real with them, to hear what you have to say and what you believe on a particular topic, and then argue from that point. But you have conflict with the administration in the school who prefers that, not prefers, they demand that you don't do that, because they don't want to have that source of tension within the classroom. How do you navigate that kind of situation?
That's a good question. Do you all feel the pressure as when you're teaching of this sort of politically corrected mandate? I know you said, you brought that up earlier. Other folks feel this? How does it matter? Like, what are the things you can't say?
What can you say?
give me an example of what you can't. Because, again, I say that only because my position is it doesn't exist. Maybe that's not really my position, but it's close to that political correctness doesn't exist. I feel like I can say almost whatever I want to say. So I want to figure out what's the politically corrected discourse. Because I find it's often not the substance of what you're saying, it's not the ideas, it's the flat-footedness of the terms you're using to say them. And that might be frustrating. It's not the end of the world. Do I prefer saying Indian to Native American? You have to think about whether I say black or African American. Like, that can trip you up and feel constricting, but it's the difference between saying one verb versus another. You learn language. Language changes. Language changes all the time. So to me, I find nothing about that atypical or constricting. I think it is problematic if I can't say the substance of what I want to say. That is a big deal. But I think that's different often from what people are talking about. Often they're talking about, you know, they have to say, you know, cisgender or, you know, there instead of just he, her, like that stuff. And you're right, if you didn't do that growing up, it takes work. But we're constantly learning a new language. To me, that's more stuff to assimilate into the arsenal you use to understand the universe. That's not constricting. Or is that the kind of stuff that you all are talking about? What were we going to add?
Yeah, I think the example we used in our class speaking about, let's say, gay rights with a heavily Caribbean student population where the parents were not open for debate, so the pressure's not coming from administration, it's coming from the potential consequences of the child going home, and then why are you teaching this? And I think that is real, as far as not that I can't say it, is that do I want to feel the consequences of what happens when I do? Mm-hmm. And I think that's what Selena was getting at, and I think, like, I have experienced that, so, like, it is real. But I guess what would you suggest we should do?
So that strikes me almost as the opposite of political correctness, in the sense that, you know, political correctness, it usually veers, we think, towards the liberal side. Yeah. And this is about you saying almost kind of conservative backlash against liberalism that feels constricted, right? I don't want folks to go back and say we're talking about gay issues, right? So again, so maybe, and that could count, that's fine, but it's not usually how it's articulated. Usually it's a sin of the political left, right? And they're the and they're the ones who are policing what other people can say. So I think it's even just an important corrective to say it can happen from every side of a political and ideological debate, right? That it, the corrected speech might be corrected or challenged from the right, not just the left. Okay, that's good, because I wasn't even thinking about kind of conservative strictures of what you could say in the classroom. But clearly, when a politicized context, well, that's one of the things academics especially worry about, right? That folks are going to get on Fox News and they're going to say, take what you say out of context and make you look like a crazy person, like a lunatic. Well, how could this person say this, you know? And there's often the stuff you take for granted at a place like Brooklyn College. You had your hand up, I'm sorry. The moment has passed.
Yeah.
Okay. So I kind of feel like I want to hear more of this stuff. So that's a really good example. That's an example that's actually, to me, atypical in a way, but still useful, because it expands my sense of what the stakes are and how the players interact. But what are the other things? Beyond, like, maybe some of it, maybe a lot of it is getting the terms right and wrong. And I can feel like a hassle. That doesn't bother me as much, but maybe it bothers other people. Is that some of it?
I was told to be apolitical, like to cause zero confrontation or have, like, not push any, or push any buttons, as you were mentioning before, in terms of, like, directing a conversation a certain way that might eventually go to something that could be politicized. It was just taking, like, an extremely straight road, not even necessarily through the middle, but one where it's just, like, concrete evidence-based.
Evidence is good. Right? I think evidence is good. I think it's a difficult channel to steer a ship through. It can get really tight, really quick. I mean, you know, again, depending on what the topics is you cover, it might be unavoidable to be talking about issues that students politicize in the classroom. You know, I think I would make a decision between being apolitical and being non-polemical, right? So I do think often being a polemicist will just end in crashing and burning. But I feel like that's different from taking seriously the political stakes of the questions we're asking. Because I think it's naive. You don't have to be, you know, someone who follows Foucault to think that knowledge, whatever the knowledge might be on, is connected to questions of power. I think, at least as an anthropologist, it would be irresponsible, I would argue, not to think about those connections. But I still want to believe we can do that in ways that provide an opportunity for students to think substantively about how they approach the links between the political and the intellectual or something, and not to be afraid to touch it like a third. I do think it's difficult, but I'm not sure the alternative is satisfying to anybody, you know, least of all the instructor, you know, who kind of almost has to be terrified in the classroom of kind of avoiding all, like I want to always feel like there's anything we can discuss, as long as we can figure out the right ways to talk about it so that it doesn't become a way of attacking this community or criticizing this student or demonizing this group. And I think there's a way to do that that's less about, at least for me, being apolitical, because I'm not sure you can pull that off in a way that's still genuine education. Again, maybe if you're teaching trigonometry, maybe. Even that I'm not sure, but maybe if you're teaching something like that. But it's hard to do that if the course is, you know, urban studies, if the course is, you know, contemporary theories in pedagogy. Like, all this stuff has political coefficients. And to pretend them away, I think, is to not do your, I would argue, to not fully embrace your role as the person who's gonna help these students deal with those issues when they leave the classroom too. So I don't know, but I do know it's tough, it's tough.
But I think that's a real issue for a teacher or an instructor, or, you know, sometimes just anyone working in academia, you know, I found that the culture in those environments was people were afraid of losing their jobs. You know, I feel like that it's a reality that they have to navigate all the time. You know, even worse, I think, in the Department of Education, you know, that is fearful, almost like people are snitching on them. You can't say this, you shouldn't do that, you know? And I think
for me, it was a rarity to find a teacher or a professor who was there, you know, and felt like, felt a different kind of commitment to what they were doing, you know, that they were able to ignore those things. But a lot of people, they just, you know, they want to be able to hold on to their livelihood.
So what are we most afraid of saying in the classroom?
And I think the nature of it is that people don't even know necessarily what is the thing that's going to be that trigger, you know, and I think it speaks to what you're saying about it really being a construct, you know, these things that, these rules that we have, you know, but the reality that something can be taken out of context and escalated, and, you know, you have all of this stuff rolling on you.
So, again, I think it's hard for everyone, but I think maybe the reason why it can sometimes feel less frustrating for some people, especially folks who study, you know, issues of difference and identity and political solidarity building and the like, is like you realize that that's the stuff that trips other faculty members up who just want to, you know, teach people about, you know, the three branches of government, you know what I mean, or something like, is like that stuff is the stuff that's the substance of what we study. Like, I'm curious about all the ways we transform the language, the labels we use to talk about who and what we are, to feel like we're embedding into our nomenclature versions of representing us that feel more empowering or more inclusive. Like, that's the stuff I care about, which is maybe why it's less frustrating because you have to learn the terms and figure out what people are thinking. But I think if that's not what you do, then it just feels like extra work. Or it feels like, you know, potential cliffs you can fall off of if you're not careful. I think, you know, I'm not sure the alternative to that is to not care, in the sense that I've seen a lot of faculty members who don't care about that stuff. And to me, when I see the dynamics in the classroom, they seem like bullies to me. Or they seem almost abusive in their indifference to what students need and want. So I think there's a version of what I want to imagine, at least for myself, I want to aspire to, that is more about saying, you know, this is tough. I know it's often not easy, but if I care about the students and I'm truly trying and willing to learn with them, that it's what we have to do for this to be worth your time and all your money. Right? And I think there's a version of that you put your hand up, what are you trying to win? I think there's a version of that that to me is different from, and I will tell you, so it's not just about losing your job, because I know tenured faculty members who are afraid to say stuff, and they're not going to lose their job. So I think there's another dynamic, or maybe they don't want to not be liked, maybe they feel like they just don't have the tools to say it well, so they don't want to feel like they're not good at articulating position, but then you have to work on it. You have to work on it. That's okay. I mean, we all know we have to keep retooling, right? You got to keep getting more credit. You got to go back. I mean, I think you just keep learning as an instructor, and that's okay. I don't feel like that's a deal breaker. But I don't buy the argument that it's about losing your job. I mean, I think that's, you know, that's the boogeyman you prop up so everyone will let you off. Okay, fine, you don't want to lose your job. I'm not sure that's what's going on here. I mean, I think what's going on is an unwillingness to roll up your sleeves and do the work. Because it's hard work to do it, especially if that's not how you're trained. And so I get that. So if that's what you do anyway, you know, there's no skin off your back in some ways. But I think if it's not, then it really is a different skill set, a whole different domain to learn. But I think in a multi-everything environment, to do the work, you have to learn.
Do you ever see any institution come down on somebody, though? You ever seen it?
For speech? Well, you can give me an example. I've been at...
No, I'm just curious to know if you've ever...
It doesn't mean it hasn't happened, but I can't recall it. Yeah. I've definitely seen students get upset at faculty who they feel like say things that are offensive or say things that... I've definitely seen that. I mean, no one loses their job because of it, but people get angry. And when I'll try to... usually because students ask me, because in some other capacity people want me to help figure out what happened. You know, I think it's often, you know, issues that are less about, that really at the end of the day are about pedagogical skill and prowess. It's folks trying to do things and not being able to kind of square the circle well enough for the strategy to work. But that happens too. And I think, but again, it has to be a context where students believe that you're invested in them too. Often the backdrop of this is this faculty member who clearly doesn't give a damn about us. You know what I mean? And I think that already primes you, gets your antenna up for the stuff you're not going to want to hear. So that I think there are all these other cues that go in. I always tell people that, I've seen instructors who just don't care. I've been in the class. And usually I don't get upset by that stuff, but I can see how and why a lack of real investment in the student's ability to use these ideas in ways that electrify them can be incredibly dangerous. Because it can turn people off to a whole bunch of things and create this environment where you are gonna be constantly at battle with students, because I would argue not because of that specific thing you said, because how that, for the folks who were with me earlier, this might not be an interview, but how that particular sign represents or stands in for something else. Right?
I was going to say that I actually agree with you. I think that you can basically say anything as long as you frame it correctly. I think you have to have a good classroom environment in which you instill in your students that you do care about them. But I also think that when you don't talk about those things, it's worse. Because they know it's like the elephant in the room. So they're wondering why you're not talking about it.
Right.
So it just makes it worse, because now everybody knows that you should say something, but then you don't. And then they're wondering why you're not saying it. So I think that when you don't address things that should be addressed, it just takes work. You gotta figure out how to navigate with the classroom that you have. So in one classroom, you may have to say something a different way because of who you have in the classroom. And you just have to work a little bit harder in certain classrooms, but you should be able to say or discuss whatever you would like to discuss. I think when we don't teach our students how to discuss and how to have these conversations about the things that are uncomfortable, once they leave school, they're not gonna be able to function in the world. So they need to, learn those things with someone who cares.
I think you said that brilliantly. And I do think if you're not saying it in the classroom, you can rest assured when the students leave, they're talking about the fact that you're not saying it.
Right.
And so I think that does continue to ramp up this sense of unhappiness about your inability to hear them.
I think one of the things that contributes to silencing discussion in the classroom, though, at the secondary level and in elementary school, is the vast regulatory apparatus that's been imposed, which is this drive to test. And so teachers who genuinely care about students frame the caring as, I care, and therefore I want them to do well on the test. So you have to then shape that discussion to do well on the test. And it's a terrible hindrance. I think sophisticated teachers know how to manage that and create critical lenses to look at the testing. But the drive to testing, that neoliberal regime is, I think, more detrimental at the K-12 level than any kind of political
threat. That's interesting. That's a good point. That's a really good point.
And I want to piggyback off of this idea. And I'm sorry, what's your name?
Chantel.
I like what you say. So, in my issue, I do agree with you. You should be able to say whatever you want. And if you're an effective teacher, you find ways to do that. And you find ways to engage your students and have them have this discourse that you want to have in the classroom. But at least in my school, the issue is, I'm an ninth grade teacher, and there's the word rigor, right? Is it rigorous enough? Mm-hmm. So there was a curriculum review, we talked about my curriculum, and my question was, I wanted to incorporate this text. They want me to stick to Engage New York. Now, if you've seen Engage New York, there's nothing but dead old white men text. And some of them, most of it isn't even full novels, okay? So now my question is it that you don't believe, there's a notion that my students can't have these really great conversations, can have discourse, can critically think about the thematics in a text that's maybe not as complex in language as you may want it to be? Is that the issue? Or going back to this testing, what is it that the text I want to integrate into my curriculum isn't doing? How is this not rigorous? What is rigor? And that's my trouble.
That's a really good point. And I do feel like it's one of these concepts that we usually just use to pummel people with, mm-hmm. right? And you know, I think often, so there are a whole bunch of ways to think about what the stakes are of these questions about Common Core, a particular curriculum across a school system. You know, one version of, again, I tell you, my attempt to figure out all sides. So one version of an argument I think people try to make for everyone reading the same book is that we're same books and we're all in the same conversation. Mm-hmm. So the question becomes, not, I would argue, whether or not your individual class reads a different set of texts, which it could do, and you're right, it would do the same amount of work as the other texts. They'd learn as much, maybe even more, right? Because they'd identify differently with the material. So they'd probably learn more. The downside of that, of course, in theory, is that it dislodges them a little bit further from the core cultural framework of the larger society. It's a version of what they are. And that's kind of very flat-footed way to say it. But then I think the question then becomes, how do we integrate the entire curriculum, not just the one for your students, but in the entire building? And to make the case, have people in a position who can make decisions about those kinds of questions that take that into account. So that you don't have to choose between being a part of everyone else's conversation and having to create a curriculum that allows your students to see themselves enough to really want to learn. But we can imagine everyone's gonna be willing and able to learn from the kinds of texts as well that your students are gonna be able to benefit from. So I do think it's a way of thinking about this these kind of questions that tries to figure out why people get so invested in policing what other people read. What are the stakes of that stuff? And we know there are a whole bunch of different ways we carve into it, but I do think ultimately the part of it that I find somewhat compelling is I do think it's hard to talk to one another if we're not talking the same language. Then it makes it more difficult to have those conversations. So I like the idea of saying, if we share some text, can't just be your text, right? Has to be, in a way, everybody. We have to find a coherent way to tell the narrative about what we read that is more inclusive in a way that doesn't just feel like we're checking off boxes. So that's a version of political correctness, right? That could be a version of, well, we can't just read Shakespeare. We got to read August Wilson, right? So I don't know if that's what you mean by political correctness. But I can see folks, you know, if they don't care about that or aren't thinking about that, well, why do I have to read August Wilson? He's no Shakespeare. You know what I mean? But I think to be really kind of sophisticated enough to recognize that it's always going to be some kind of trade-off between imagining we're adjudicating between what's the most sort of masterful example of a particular genre of writing with what's the way to make sure we're all involved in the conversation in a way that takes our presence seriously. I think we need more people to say that that's valuable. So, you know, I do feel like one of the reasons why I enjoy being dean at a relatively small school is, as dean of my school, the buck does stop with me. We don't do what I don't say we do, right? So at least it means if I'm sensitive to it, I can try to make sure it informs decisions we make about mandatory classes, right? In a way, but I think it means folks being educated in the genuine utility of that form of curricular inclusion, you know, and not thinking it's some sort of version of political correctness. But I could see someone dismissing it as that if they don't think about other things besides just what they imagine to be some objective meritocratic version of what the best texts are. I mean, that bothers me. I'm not sure there is a best text. Right? I think you get different things from different texts. I always tell people, the book I haven't taught it again in a long time, but I was blown away teaching Push. I don't know if you remember, you know, with some students in Harlem, that book changed their lives. It moved me to teach that book. And that's a book that plays with everything you take for granted about what a sort of high literary text should look like. It's incredible. And so I think to be willing and able to say, we can learn if we're innovative enough, if we care enough, if we're connected enough to our students from a whole bunch of different kinds of texts. So it doesn't have to be Shakespeare for them to get the story of what drama is. You know what I mean? Or something like that.
So I'm hearing a lot of, you know, promoting open discussion and constantly, you know, trying to get each other to listen to one another and whatnot. But from my peers, I often hear that, you know, the student raises a, a certain question or a certain topic, we'll talk to you at a later time, or I'll talk to you, in private. Would you say that's just as bad as kind of dismissing it, or would it be easily like considered a cop out?
You'd have to give me an example of the question for me to say in all terms, but I think yes, most of the time it's probably a cop out. But it's often teachers only cop out because it'd be tough for them to figure out how to deal with it effectively. So I get it too. What, you're gonna give me an example of a question?
I guess like even the election. It was times we talked about in class about the election, and I guess some of my peers would say, I'd rather address the student on my own time rather than, would you promote that discussion in class and so, talk about your personal experience?
So again, part of what I think I would have to tease out is the topic brought up in the question and the theme of the course, right? So if it's a course about electrical engineering, maybe that's a tough one to handle, right? Maybe that isn't the venue for. Again, do I feel, as someone who's watching that electrical engineering professor negotiate that question, do I feel like they're copping out by saying this isn't the venue for that? I don't think so. If the course is, contemporary electoral politics, or if the course is race and class in America, right? Or if the course is just urban issues,
Or social studies.
I think that's fair game. But I think the question becomes like, you don't want to be an instructor whose only response is to give students your own very partisan assumptions and opinions about it, right? So I think the trap you fall into is someone brings up a question about the election and your mode is, let's bash Trump, let's find a way to bash Trump. I think that's easy. I don't think anybody benefits from that. I think the real question is, so I'd have to hear the specifics of the question, but I want to make sure it's the right question to ask vis-a-vis the current political situation. And it might not be. So often the thing I'll do is I'll tweak the question and say, that's not the question we should be asking. That's a good question. Here's the even better one. Still stays with the theme, but does it in a way that allows us to talk about something other than, Trump is such a horrible person. Okay, I'm not sure anyone's going to get it from that. It might be cathartic at some level for some people. But I don't think that's pedagogically useful in most contexts. So that's, I think, a version of being willing to say, it's not, the issue isn't the question or the subject so much, it's the way we frame it so that we can actually have something constructive to say to the issues that undergird it or something like that. But I feel like that's a skill, to be able to say, okay, I hear your question, this is a better version of it that I think we can actually constructively use.
Well, I find that interesting that you put it that way, because I feel, and right before my colleague, he's also my colleague, brought up his question. I was thinking a lot of teachers, we may stray away because either we're too bound by the lesson plan and we want to stick to that plan and reach our objective, and there's this fear of unknown as to where the conversation will lead and how to do that. And so, as teachers, we may feel more confident down the road. We know how to, gather. And so if we take the question, your example of, okay, well, how do we make your question a little bit more relevant as to what we are studying, that would then quell some fears about eventually getting back on track as to what the lesson is, or being able to tie it into whatever the lesson is of that day, or in general, the overview of the course, whether it just be a general, global studies class or history class. And so, I think just even your point of saying like, okay, well, is that the question, or is this going to now be the question? Let me ask your question, or let me give you another question to think about.
I think one of the reasons why I'm pretty confident that's doable, because usually students aren't throwing out non sequiturs. Usually there's some reason why that question is coming up in that moment. So they might not always be sort of masterful about how to make sure they frame it in a way that highlights why it's relevant, but you should be able to do that. And again, with practice, you can do it relatively quickly. But I do think you're right. This is another pressure goes back to, you have an agenda, too. Like, you don't want to get, and students will get frustrated if they feel like you're taking up too much time on a question that isn't relevant. Right? They're paying money, or they're in school at their time. They don't want to be there anyway. But I do think there's a way in which, if you can do that well, that students can then recognize that this isn't an aside, this is straight down the middle of what's going to get you to your curricular finish line for that day or something.
Going back to this idea of political correctness, so I think that there's a very big distinction between what I view political correctness as, I view it as synonymous with dishonesty. I don't understand the need for political correctness, but I'm also the type of person who will say, I don't understand, could you teach me, or could you explain to me? And I think that that kind of shows why I would like associated with dishonesty, mm-hmm. because I am apparently one of like not many people who say I don't get it or I don't understand or if you explain your perspective and act like and listen to the answer. I feel like what one of the good things about Brooklyn College is that most people here are open to hearing that other perspective a little bit, but it's not something that you see in the classroom so much. First of all, just because with time comes the maturity to realizing that, okay, even if this is something that I knew my whole life, it doesn't mean that it's completely true. And I think that they kind of need that time to develop through what we teach mm-hmm. them. That's part A. But then bringing that into the classroom, I think that, so when I will bypass or reframe a question, or I will kind of say, could you speak to me after class, or could we talk about it in this context? I'm not doing it so much because I don't want to be politically correct, I want to be politically correct about it. I'll go research the topic. If I don't feel confident, and I'll tell them that. I'll tell them, I'll be like, listen, I want you to come talk to me after because, or to bring it up again tomorrow because I need time to research both perspectives. Like, there's topics that I'm very confident in, my knowledge of, and therefore we're able to have more open ended discussions. Like, we're doing the Palestinian-Israeli conflict right now. I spent a good 8 years of my life just reading anything that I could, both sides, hearing each side, anything I get my hands on, I read. So we're doing that now, and I'm just like, ask me whatever you want, just frame it respectfully, but we can have a conversation about it. But then when I'm teaching about apartheid in Africa, I'm just like, that's not my area of knowledge right now. I need time, we're kind of learning it together. So I think that there is this difference between being politically correct and then realizing about yourself, I don't know everything, and I'm gonna have to kind of take a step back and then we can talk about it, but don't be afraid to tell them that.
I think you're absolutely right. And I do think that's one of the versions maybe of maybe it's not losing your job, but losing your credibility.
Yeah.
Like, we're often afraid to say we don't know.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think, again, another one of the liberating aspects, clearly, you know, I'm just a shill for the discipline of anthropology, but, you know, another version of what ethnographers do unabashedly is ask questions and say, I have no idea what you're saying. Please explain it to me. And to be able to find a pedagogical perch from which to do that in a way that doesn't feel like you're compromising your authority in the classroom. It sounds like you found a very like powerful position to occupy as a teacher, so that you don't have to feel like it's either I know everything or I'm not good at my job. But I think that's a nice point.
Yeah, I think it's kind of in line with what was just said, but it's sometimes it would be, in my case, because of age. When I was student teaching in the seventh grade, some of the students didn't have the maturity to be able to respectfully convey their point, and the concern was bullying other students rather than some sort of fear I had in trying. So if I were to say to speak after class, it would be so I can convey to you the way in which you can say your opinion respectfully, not because I'm, you know, afraid of anything really. It's mm-hmm. just mm-hmm. I want you to be able to not, you stupid, you understand, like that, which is what would happen. And so that's kind of really why I intend to do that.
And you're right, very different scenario. And I do think, you know, I look at folks who teach, you know, eighth grade or even 12th grade, and I'm like, I don't know how you all, I mean, that's such difficult work. Because at least, you know, in a place like this, all you're really trying to do is get them the information. You know, like, they're there most of the time because they're disciplined enough to know they at least have to perform investment. You know, we go into these high schools for a semester, and students, they don't have to perform nothing. You know what I mean? And this, so it takes a different kind of skill to even draw them in enough. I think, again, I still think, this is what I said in my talk on Wednesday, I think one of the ways you can potentially get those kids is just show them you really care about them. And some of the ways you care might be to say, well, I'm not going to embarrass you here. I'm not going to, you know, we're going to talk after. I'm going to show you how and why. I think you want to approach this differently. But I think being able to both teach and do all the other stuff you have to do when, you know, you're anywhere but in a college teaching young people is takes so many different kinds of skill sets.
And I think when dealing with younger students, I agree with you, right? I teach ninth grade. I have a couple. My colleague who teaches 11th grade, the discourse in her classroom is obviously so much different than what's happening in my class. But especially when we're talking about controversial issues, it's super important to start with perspective, okay? Talking about perspective and getting them to understand, especially at the seventh grade level, what each of these perspectives are. So for example, we're reading The Curious Incident of the Dog in the Nighttime right now. And so we're talking about autism. And they're so easy to say, oh, that's retarded, you know? So from the beginning, I started off with a simulation video. Okay, mm-hmm. you feel what it's like to be autistic. Now, mm-hmm. the questions about, oh, but are they retarded and different, all of that is out of the way now because you put yourself in that person's shoes. So whenever we're dealing with younger kids, I think it's important to start there.
Mm, that's good. And I do think it sounds like, you know, you found ways to at least get past some of what might be the anxious sort of walls put up to stop them from having the mm-hmm. conversation. Because, you know, sometimes they know this can be deep, this can be hard. But I do think trying to find ways to take the pressure off of them around to feel like they can feel like they're in a safe enough space to do it in a way that will ultimately be okay for them is a really powerful starting point, at least. But ultimately, I do think, you know, we're all going to take different approaches in the classroom. That's probably fine. Students need to have variety too, right? If we're all doing the same thing, even if the same love thing, that's probably after a while going to get stale. But I do think there's some way to figure out what your kind of version of an authentic teachingly self is, and to know that even that is going to have to change a little bit depending on the specific context of instruction. You know, so for me, you know, I do know, just a few weeks ago, I had to do a couple of engagements in middle schools and high schools, very different. But I do know one tool that I feel like always works is, you know, often they'll bring, you know, I get the best students in the store, so I know I get, but, you know, you give students a space to explain to you what they're thinking and why they're thinking it, and to listen to one another, I think there's almost no way that goes wrong. I feel like some of that, though, is demonstrating respect, even when they don't quite have the language yet, for the essence of what they're representing and why they're there. Because, you know, the reason, the positions that they would even take that feel dismissive or even offensive, I mean, these are young kids. They're taught to negotiate those spaces in particular kinds of ways. And so I think your job is to get them to feel comfortable enough to not just go there because they know that's a safe way to get a laugh, rather than get out of the situation, but to figure out like how to get them to sit with it long enough to really think about it. Again, maybe just for 15 minutes today. But I think the more you can do that, the more students feel like this is something worth their time and energy, and that'll benefit them in some way, no matter what kind of job they want to have when they get out. But hopefully, I know we only have 5 more minutes. I don't know if there are other questions or comments or concerns. I mean, I do think just going back to the DiCardio racism stuff, that one of the things in the classroom I'm always trying to figure out, and I never really know, is what students are actually thinking, you know? Like that's what I always want to know, what are they thinking? And sometimes you maybe kind of get a sense of one person, they're really, but often they're doing what you're doing, they're just staring at you. You know? and so for me, it is about trying to figure out what are the ways I can confirm for myself that they're getting something, right? That they're feeling. I think this, again, this small sliver of what I still try to carry over from my small stint as a stand-up comedian in high school, to try to figure out that audience, like what's working, what's not working. The one thing you've seen me do, but I've tried to be more disciplined about it too, is, you know, I'll never just tell students or explain stuff to students in one way. I'll do it in 7 different ways. You know what I mean? Because I realize it's only the 7th time that the kid in the corner is gonna get it, you know? But even for the folks who got it earlier, it can help reinforce it to get it told in a slightly different way. It can help cement it a little bit more. So I don't feel that bad. But that's one of the things I know I do to make sure everyone has this. Because often I think it's, because one of the things, you know, it's like you'll be in class and you think you know it. And literally, as soon as you walk out of that door, it's gone. Like, what? I knew this stuff. And so just trying to get a way to make it stick, right? So they can live it and hold on to it and then rethink it when they leave and really understand it, to me is key. So the one thing I'm always trying to figure out is what's the best way to read the crowd. So I don't think I can read you all, but at least there's one more hand and then I'll let you go.
Culture is relative. Sometimes someone doesn't understand what someone's saying, so they'll yell it louder and louder instead of using another word or using their hands. And I don't know how related it is, but the definition of a foreigner is someone who knows one more language than you do.
Well put. I think there is a way in which, you know, we want to imagine we can use techniques to communicate more effectively that actually don't communicate any more effectively. Just, you're right, more emphatically, non-communicatively. And so I do think if there's a way to figure out the strategies that are working, not for every student. So that's why I still think you're going to have to try to figure out what are the different tools you use for different kinds of learners. But to be willing to say, it's not working simply because I'm saying it louder, right? Or because I'm using a particular jargon that I know works in the literature. That language might not help you. You might have to break it down in a way that really gets beyond the terms to demonstrate to the students a way of understanding it they can really hold on to. And I think that is something, at least for me, I'm sort of constantly trying to find better ways of doing in the classroom. So thank you all. I appreciate it. Yeah, I know it's late.